worker, social worker, and for which she felicitated for outstanding work in screening of cervical cancer in female sex workers of urban slums of Bhubaneswar by Women Doctors Forum, and facilitated the outstanding women toxicity on the International Women's Day 2020, associated editor of our textbook Do's and Don't Do's of Obstetric Gynecological Practice. She has more than 100 publications in international and national journals, invited resource person based in national and international conference. One thing she has omitted, that is, one is she is for the last one decade, I am seeing her in all conference as a presenting a paper or presenting a poster with a lot of postgrad students taking with her and participating in the seminar, slide seminar or symposium as a moderator or participant. With all, she is very active in the IPF and on the whole, is a bright in star in IAPM academic field. So with this remark, I just introduction, there are a lot of things are there, but there is no time to do it. I request her to start the topic that very interesting topic, and pathology, clear cells in pathology, histomorphologic approach to the diagnosis. Two parts where you'll find there is a, once is a clear cells in pathology in one part, and histomorphology approach to the diagnosis in another part. So this becomes very important, and I think she'll just, please start.
Thank you very much, sir, for the kind words. So today's session is session 5 of IAPM webinar, Clear Cells in Pathology, Histomorphologic Approach to Diagnosis. I'll start this with a very good evening to all of you. Respected Professor Dr. Vatsala Mishra, President IAPM, moderator of the session, Professor G.N. Mahanty, all the past presidents, executives of IAPM, members, colleagues, and postgraduates.
Santi, please do it full screen. Full screen, Carlo presentation. You can do it full screen.
Okay, madam. So, begging blessings from Lord Jagannath for the whole development of IAPM and the members of IAPM. Now, I'll start this. As you all know, there is tremendous development in the field of surgical pathology, but still histopathology remains the gold standard of diagnosis. And while during microscopic examination, we come across a lot of findings like inclusions, granules, globules, groovings, halos, clearings, pigments, and different bodies. Now, clear cell change is one of these important findings. These clear change can be caused due to some artifactual or natural cause, can be seen in, like madam told, non-neoplastic or tumorous conditions. Tumors also can again be primary or secondary. So analysis of clear cells in itself is a very extensive and exhaustive area. And I will try to do justice to the different clear cell lesions found in different categories with examples and case discussions. So this session today is all about the clear cells in pathology. Now, while preparing this session, I came across a case, an interesting case of a 51-year-old female who presented with ovarian tumor. Grossly, it was mostly cystic of around 8 centimeters in diameter, but the wall was thickened. Naturally, we took the grass from the wall. And you can see here the presence of the cuboidal cells with slight hobnailing. And underneath that, there were some solid nests of cells which were round to polygonal. So it was confusing. Then we regressed it. Still, you can see here some tubular areas with nuclear hobnailing. Now, in this area, you can clearly see some solid nests of round to polygonal cells with abundant clear cytoplasm. And these cells we thought as clear cells. And due to presence of these clear cells and the nuclear hobnailing in the cyst lining, we gave a diagnosis of clear cell carcinoma of ovary. Now, this presence of the clear cells helped us in giving the diagnosis. This was another area in that tumor, tubular structures lined by cuboidal cells. Now, what are clear cells? Clear cells can be actually cuboidal, columnar, or round to polygonal large cells with abundant pale eosinophilic to clear cytoplasm, centrally placed vesicular nucleus, and conspicuous nucleoli. So the word clear may be a misnomer because sometimes we may get a lot abundant amount of pale eosinophilic granular cytoplasm. Now this case was from a 48-year-old female with a right side ovarian tumor. This was slightly easy to diagnose, and you can see a mixture of different patterns in this tumor, which may be seen separately or simultaneously in any case. Here we are seeing mostly solid nests of round to polygonal cells with voluminous cytoplasm, clear, mostly clear cytoplasm, described as the solid pattern of clear cell carcinoma. Here you can see thick, stout papillae with hyalinized core lined by the cuboidal cells and with presence of hyaline globules. I can tell here this the hyalinized core of the papillae and the presence of hyaline globules are the two important diagnostic clue which differentiates clear cell carcinoma from other epithelial malignancies of ovary or endometrium. Here you can see the tubular pattern along with microcystic spaces lined by cuboidal atypical cells and the nuclei are protruding into the lumen known as nuclear hobnailing. This is a very classical pattern of clear cell carcinoma. Another area showing stratified columnar cells with nuclear hobnailing. So what do you mean exactly by clear cell carcinoma? Clear cell carcinomas should almost always and exclusively have a preponderance of the clear cells, which should have a solid boundary and lot of clear pale cytoplasm filled with glycogen. They can be seen any part of the body, but still they comprise a very small proportion of the cases, and these tumors have a bad prognosis, not because they have a lot of pleomorphism, but because they have a very low proliferation rate. And because of this low proliferation rate, they respond badly to chemotherapy. Now, when we discuss about this clear cell carcinoma, this has morphologic overlap with Yolk sac tumor because of the papillary pattern and presence of the hyaline globules. So in these cases, we have to differentiate clear cell carcinoma from Yolk sac tumor. Now, Yolk sac tumors are usually seen in younger age with cellular duval bodies and hyaline globules. The hyaline globules in clear cell carcinoma is PAS positive, but in Yolk sac tumor, it is alpha fetoprotein positive. Now, clear cell carcinomas are negative for alpha fetoprotein, positive for napsin A and Emma. So this can give us a clear cut diagnosis. This was a very interesting case. A 42-year-old female clinically diagnosed as carcinoma body of endometrium. Now, we received the specimen caught up on the uterus and cervix with bilateral appendages. Now the uterus was enlarged. There was a diffuse fungating tribal mass involving whole of the endometrial surface. Here also in the ovary, you can see one side, there was a follicular cyst and the other side was solid, grayish white and nodular appearance. But the contour of ovary was maintained. The other ovary was normal. Now microsection showed again solid nests of clear cells. Here, this nest of clear cells are invading into myometrium, known as myometrial invasion. From the ovary, we mostly got the tubulocystic pattern of the clear cell carcinoma with some solid nest. You can see the fibrous capsule here, intact fibrous capsule of the ovary. So we are dealing with a clear cell carcinoma involving endometrium and ovary simultaneously. So here we have to answer the question to the clinician, if the endometrium is primary with ovary metastasis or vice versa, or both are synchronous primaries. Now, if they had been of this similar histology, you could have told they are different primary. When they are of the similar morphology, we have to discuss, differentiate in these two, and we have to stamp a case as what it is. Now, in these cases, hypothesis can help us. It goes like this. If the endometrial carcinoma is large in size of high grade with myometrial invasion, and ovarian tumor is small, solid, and nodular, usually it is bilateral, but in this case it is unilateral, then we can stamp this case as the endometrial primary clear cell carcinoma with metastasis to ovary. I can tell you here, immunohistochemistry and flow cytometry doesn't help here to decide which one is primary. A 60-year-old female with cervical biopsy. You can see here some cuboidal cells with hubnailing and some acinar pattern and some small areas showing presence of clear cells. Now, higher magnification, you can see again acinar pattern with cuboidal cells and some nest of clear cells. So, this was diagnosed as a clear cell carcinoma of cervix. Here, I must tell you, the students mostly, the additional findings of clear cell carcinoma are they different in different areas of clear cell carcinoma? The answer is yes and no. That is, the additional features like hubnailing and presence of hyaline globules are seen clear cell carcinoma of female genital tract, but they are not seen in other areas. We must keep that in mind. This was another interesting case similar to clear cell carcinoma. A 30-year-old female underwent Wardian cystectomy for carcinoma cervix. Now, the gross showed a bulky uterus with a large fungating bulky mass involving ecto endo cervix along with the lower uterine segment. The mass was solid and grayish white in color. We took sections. And here you can see the non-keratinized stratified squamous epithelium without any dysplastic change. Underlying it, you can see the tumor cells annexed mostly in nest and also at places in solid pattern. In this low power also, you can see the dense, heavy inflammatory background of the tumor. Now here you can see again inflammatory cell infiltration. Look at the cells. They are again large, round to polygonal, voluminous cytoplasm. Now let's have a still higher, close look. Here in the lumen of the cell nest, you can see neutrophilic infiltration, which is not seen in other area, other carcinomas. And look at the cells. They have a faint eosinophilic granular cytoplasm resembling the ground glass, giving a ground glass appearance. So this is known as the glassy cell carcinoma. Now, the glassy cell carcinoma, as you might be knowing, is a poorly differentiated adenosquamous carcinoma of the cervix. So we subjected this to immunohistochemistry, and it was positive for both adenomarker and squamous marker, like CEA and high molecular weight keratin, CK7. However, it was negative for P63. Now, till now, I told about the carcinomas, clear cell carcinomas of the female genital tract, but they are not only confined to the female genital tract. I think the students can recognize this specimen, the bean shaped organ attached to the ureter. You can see the cortex here, and a large globular grayish white yellowish at places mass arising from cortex and bulging into the medulla. This is from a 32-year-old female presenting with hematuria and flank pain. Now, histology showed presence of the normal renal tissue in the periphery with a fibrous capsule and the tumor tissue underlying it comprising of nests of clear cells with a prominent vasculature. Higher magnification, you can see alveolar nests of clear cells surrounded by sinusoidal blood vessels. Still higher magnification, you can see again pale eosinophilic abundant cytoplasm, centrally placed small nuclei, alveolar nest and tubular pattern of the tumor cells, and surrounded by the sinusoidal blood vessel. Now, two diagnostic clues here for this diagnosis of this is renal cell carcinoma are, commonly we get sinusoidal pattern in renal cell carcinoma and rarely papillary pattern. If we encounter any renal carcinoma with papillary features, presence of papillae, we must think twice before giving a diagnosis of clear cell carcinoma. So, renal cell carcinoma in kidney is not difficult to diagnose. But if we get such features in extrarenal site, then for a diagnosis of metastatic renal cell carcinoma clear cell type, we have to first look for a clinically and radiologically detectable renal mass. Along with that, other features like lipid, intracytoplasmic lipid, large sinusoidal spaces. But remember, pronounced cytological atypia should go against renal cell carcinoma. Now, renal cell carcinomas are notorious in metastasizing to different sites like lung and bone. We encounter a case of metastatic clear cells in the lymph node. You can see in the aspirate also, there are a lot of these clear cells in the lymph node. I think this can tell you what is the mother tissue. We can see the urothelium, the stratified columnar epithelium here, underlying it is the tumor tissue, mostly arranged in the tubulocystic pattern. This was from a 35-year-old female who presented with dysuria, frequency, hematuria, and urgency. Cystoscopy revealed a papillary ulcerative growth on the posterior wall of the bladder. You can see here nest of clear cells clearly, and the tubulocystic pattern with nuclear hubnailing. Here you can see the invasion into muscularis propria of the tumor. So this was a clear cell carcinoma of urinary bladder. Now, what do you think here? Are they the renal cell carcinoma clear cell type? You can see clearly the cores of the tumor cells, small nest, tubular pattern of numerous clear cells with abundant clear cytoplasm. Now, what it is lacking than this renal cell carcinoma is absence of the sinusoidal blood vessels, is not present. But what is present is the fascicles, intervening fascicles of connective tissue. Now, this is the hypernephroid pattern of adenocarcinoma prostate, known as Gleason score 4B. So, what we understood from this discussion till now is clear cell carcinomas are most common in female genital tract and lower urinary tract. But that doesn't mean it is not seen in other places. So, it can be seen, like I told you, in any organ of the body, starting from head and neck, CNS, salivary gland, skin, bone, soft tissue, liver, GI tract, and so many other organs. So, we can see some of those malignancies. Have a look here. These are cystic spaces lined by the with the presence of mucous cells, and here you can see the presence of nondescript dark intermediate cells, and some areas show presence of clear cells. So this is a tumor of parotid of a 32-year-old female. You can again see here diffusely present clear cells. So we are dealing with a clear cell containing lesion or tumor of salivary gland. Now, if you want to analyze them, they can be benign and malignant. Benign can be oncocytoma, myoepithelioma. Malignant can again be either primary or secondary. In primary, this can be some tumors with clear-cut presence of clear cells, or some tumors where there is no clear cell, but a myoepithelial cell will look like clear cells. Now, those can be either myoepithelial carcinoma or epithelial myoepithelial carcinoma. Those tumors which showed clear cells, if they are preponderantly containing clear cell, then it is known as clear cell carcinoma. If only few areas are showing, then it could be mucoepidermal carcinoma or acinic cell carcinoma. Now, how are we going to differentiate them? Now, special strain plays a great role in diagnosis in these cases, because as I have already told, clear cells are positive with past 10 and mucous cells are positive in mucocarmin. So this is how we can differentiate the clear cell carcinomas. Past 10 was positive in this particular case. And we subjected this to immunohistochemistry, P63 and CK7 were positive. So this was a case of mucoepidermal carcinoma, clear cell type. So the diagnostic clue is mucocarmin positivity for mucous cells is the clue in mucoepidermal carcinoma salivary gland, in other clear cell tumors of salivary gland, because they are not seen in clear cell carcinomas of salivary gland. Now the question here is, are all clear cells malignant? Because I have only told you about the clear cell carcinomas. So are they all malignant? No. This is the sentence, just imagine, given by Nasser in 1997. What he had told that time also, clear cell changes may be virtually observed in any non-neoplastic, benign or malignant tumor of epithelial, mesenchymal, adnexal, melanocytic and hematopoietic origin. So you can encounter clear cell during your practice in any organ, in any origin. Now clear cells can be physiological or pathological. Physiological clear cells, you might all be knowing, myoepithelial cells, mucous acinar cells, secretory cells, eccrine sweat gland cells, melanocytes and Langerhans cells. But pathological can again be non-neoplastic lesions and benign or malignant tumors. So clear cell change in non-neoplastic lesions is attributed to mostly artifactual changes or improper cellular preservation, hydrophilic degeneration of organelle or deposition of, contrary to our belief of only glycogen causes clearing, it can be due to anything like glycogen, mucopolysaccharides, lipids, mucins, and phagocytose clear foreign material. This is the age-old classification of the clear cell lesions according to location. It can be seen, like I told you, from the head and neck till the toes, like in the brain, salivary gland, lungs, then GI tract, kidney, liver, ovary, uterus, and skin bone surface. Like now, according to biological behavior, clear cell lesions can be, this is the way we approach the clear cell lesions. It can be non-neoplastic or neoplastic. Non-neoplastic, I told. Non-neoplastic can be primary or secondary. Primary can again be epithelial, like benign malignant, and mesenchymal, again benign and malignant. So I try to touch some of the lesions from each category. Now, coming to the non-neoplastic clear cell changes, what is this? I think it's not difficult for the residents to diagnose this. This is a proliferative endometrium. Hey, who is you? Proliferative endometrium, where you can see presence of clear cells. Look here. There are small cells with pycnotic nucleus and presence of a clear halo surrounding the nuclei. So these are known as clear cells in proliferative endometrium. This is the hyperplastic endometrium. This is the hyperplastic endometrium. So in crowding of the endometrial glands, you can see the clear cells here. Still higher magnification, presence of a clear cells. Now what is its significance? Most important is they signify a benign change. And another thing is they can be identified easily so that it can help us in diagnosis of proliferative or hyperplastic endometrium. Another thing is, sometimes the clear cells can be only evidence of pathogenic activity in a weakly proliferative endometrium. Now this one, the closest degree of clear cell culture of endometrium, seen in endometrium. Look here. You can see dilated glands lined by clear cells with focal stratification and nuclear atypia. Higher magnification, you can see stratification, hobnailing, nuclear atypia, mild to moderate. Still higher magnification, you can see. So this is a case of area stella phenomenon. It was first characterized by area stella, and later it was designated in this name. Now you can see the ectocervical epithelium, the non-keratinized stratified squamous epithelium. So in presence of lot of phyllocytes, which indicates HPV infection. Now Jacob granulomatous inflammation can be seen in any organ, starting from endometrium, fallopian tube, ovary, gallbladder, appendix, and so many organs. They are characterized by presence of cysts of OMI macrophages admixed with both acute and chronic inflammatory cells. You can also see few parenchymatic type of giant cells here. So clear cells can be a positive flow, but it can also be a diagnostic pitfall.
Let me show you. See, this was a very tricky situation where the top is by she was obtained from a 60-year-old male complaining of carcinoma of prostate. Clinically diagnosed as carcinoma of prostate. The PSA was the borderline
11 nanogram per milliliter.
You can see these cells, they look like clear cells, and you can jump to give a diagnosis of clear adenocarcinoma of prostate, again hypernephroid type. But these are actually the degenerated cells,
and these are all known as
artificial clearing. Another case where you can see numerous carcinoma in the prostatic biopsy, where the cells are looking clear, but you can see very small nuclei, and this can be differentiated from adenocarcinoma prostate by seeing presence of basal cell layer. So that's why I told, before jumping to diagnosis of clear cell carcinoma, think twice. Now discussing a few benign clear cell tumors. Can you identify these girls? This was a globular, grayish white mass, well circumscribed, showing some areas which are softer than the rest, and then this liquid, they look liquid. This was from a 35-year-old female with a clinical diagnosis of myoma uterus. Now, look here. You can see first cells of smooth muscle cells, but after a cells, you are seeing the cells which look like epithelial and arranged closely packed with each other. So we are dealing with epithelial leiomyoma. This is not a classical leiomyoma. Epithelial leiomyoma can be of three types. Leiomyoblastoma, which gives a fried egg appearance. Clear cell leiomyoma, which shows presence of voluminous clear cytoplasm. And a plexiform leiomyoma, where it can get cause of small cells. Now in this particular case, we are seeing fascicles of smooth muscle cells with alternating with the seeds of clear cells. Look here. You can see mild degree of nuclear hematopoiesis. Fascicles of smooth muscle cells and the alternating clear cell areas. So this is a clear cell leiomyoma, which is one type of atypical leiomyoma, but can be differentiated due to absence of mitotic figures and coagulatory necrosis. This was a subcutaneous nodule of a 22-year-old female over the forehead. Now you can see here the stratified squamous epithelium or the epidermis and the intradermal
tumor tissue
arranged in nodules. This tumor is not connected to the epidermis. You can see nodular aggregates of tumor cells, and here you can see ductal structure joined by the tumor cells. At places, these tumor cells are showing presence of clear to pale eosinophilic cytoplasm. So this is the nodular hidradenoma or clear cell hidradenoma or eccrine acrospiroma. It is given different names because sometimes we may not get clear cells in all the tumors. Now some CNS cases. A 20-year-old female with a mass in the left parietal region. In the CT, you can see a large mass which is both solid and cystic and attached to DRA. In MRI, we can see the heterogeneous mass with contrast enhancement and with a solid boundary, again attached to the DRA. This was the glass which we received. It was a globular, grayish, white, large, solid and cystic mass measuring 6 × 4 × 4 cm. The cystic area contains the hemorrhagic material. The sections were taken. Now here you can clearly know the presence of the meningothelial cells in a whole pattern. But at some foci, we saw this nondescript clear cells. Now should we give it as a diagnosis of clear cell meningioma or meningothelial meningioma? Now the clear cell meningioma have certain specific features, like they are usually seen in CP angle or caudal epithelial region, and these clear cells must be past positive
And another very important feature is that we should not see any classical meningioma, or should be rarely present. So because of that, we declare it as a diagnosis of meningothelial meningioma with clear cell chain. But why should we bother? Now this has a very high recurrence rate. The clear cell meningioma had an aggressive behavior because they are included under WHO grade 2. Now, choroid meningioma and clear cell meningioma are under WHO grade 2, and they have 8-fold higher recurrence rate. That is why when we see meningothelial meningioma with clear cells, we must think again before giving the diagnosis of clear cell meningioma. Another case, a 27-year-old female presented with intraventricular space occupying lesion. Clinically diagnosed could be choroid plexus papilloma or intraventricular glioma. Now, CT showed a very well defined heterogeneous mass in the lateral and third ventricle. And MRI showed again heterogeneous mass well defined with solid boundary. Gross was multiple bits of grayish white soft tissue measuring 1 into 0.5 into 0.3 centimeter. The tumor's tissue was mostly monotonous looking with intervening fibrillar zones and a prominent vasculature. Here you can see the monotonous cells, large cells with moderate to abundant amount of pale eosinophilic to clear cytoplasm, centrally placed vesicular nuclei and conspicuous nuclear light. Still high magnification shows the prominent vasculature with the tumor cells palisading around the vessels, giving a pseudo-rosetoid pattern. Now we are dealing with a clear cell tumor of the central nervous system. This, if you rule out this, we have three entities in the cerebrum, which can be oligodendroglioma, clear cell ependymoma, or a neurocytoma. Now this tumor was immunohistochemically strong and diffusely positive for neuron-specific annulus and synaptophysin. It was negative for glyphosphorylated acidic protein and EMMA, ruling out the possibility of oligodendroglioma and ependymoma. And the MID index to the antibody KI67 was in the range of 5 to 7%, which is considered the highest proliferating age. Now if it is more than 2, we think it is high, but it was highest. That's why we gave a diagnosis of atypical neurocytoma or proliferating neurocytoma. It has a bad prognosis and the patient expired within 6 months. Some of the clear cell sarcomas. Knowingly, I have kept this in the distinctive separate category because they have specific features. There are only few entities and differ from other types of clear cell carcinomas. Now let's have a look. And this was the renal, right renal mass from a 2-year female child. You can see the large globular mass inside the kidney. Here also you can see that mass. This is attached to the ureter, and this is a naturally malignant renal tumor, and clinically they thought it as a nephroblastoma or Wilms' tumor. Here you can see the compressed renal tissue in the periphery, presence of fibrous capsule, and the tumor tissue arranged in short fascicles, and you can clearly see some amount of clear cytoplasm here also. Higher magnification, you can see the spindle cells, short fascicles. Now here, they are highly pleomorphic, arranged with intervening this connective tissue septas, and they had also, of course, a prominent vasculature. So this was diagnosed as a case of, here you can see the clear cells, which were seen in some foci. They are large cells, again, with eosinophilic granular cytoplasm, with some entrapped tubules in between the clear cells, and this was diagnosed as a clear cell sarcoma of kidney. It is a bone metastasizing tumor of the kidney, but this clear cell sarcoma and nomenclature is considered a misnomer in this case,
because all clear cell sarcomas of kidney do not reveal clear cell change, may not reveal. Now, immunohistochemistry is non-specific in these cases because they are diffusely only positive for vimentin. Only we have to differentiate this from the monophagic Wilms tumor, the spindle cell or blast mesenchymal type, where we will get WT1 positivity. Another case from a 42-year-old female with a nodule over foot, a large nodule arising from the deep tissues, and it was covered by skin. The mass was around 5 × 3 × 3 cm, solid, grayish white. This was the section taken from the mass. You can see the hypertrophied squamous epithelium here, and the tumor tissue arranged in fascicles. They are spindle to elongated. Here you can see some areas show presence of cells with clear cytoplasm, like you can see here, and very small amount of melanin was seen in the tumor. So this is a clear cell sarcoma of the deep tissue, otherwise known as malignant melanoma of subpart. Now, malignant melanoma and clear cell sarcoma, they are two entities which are histologically, immunohistochemically, and ultrastructurally similar. They are positive for HMB45. Both the entities are positive for HMB45 also, but they have the cytogenetic difference. The translocation 12/20T is positive in clear cell sarcoma, but not in melanoma. And melanomas are usually seen superficial, not deep like this. And they should show lot of, even though not always, they should show lot of melanin pigmentation, and the cells are highly pleomorphic in case of malignant melanoma. Other some clear cell sarcomas can be clear cell chondrosarcoma, clear cell leiomyosarcoma, rhabdomyosarcoma, osteosarcoma, alveolar subpart sarcoma, and liposarcoma. Now, how do we approach to the clear cell lesions? I am towards the end of my session. Now, first exclude the mimics and the non-neoplastic lesions. Then exclude the possible of, now if you are thinking of it as a malignant tumor, exclude the possibility of metastasis. Now, if considering primary malignant tumor of clear cell origin, then have to find these things. Search for this, like polygonal cells with abundant pale to clear cytoplasm, high grade nuclear features, presence of hyaline globules, and or hobnailing of nuclei. So finally, even though I told a lot of things towards the advantages of clear cells, they might have some disadvantages and demerits also. Like this clear cell change, if we get in a tissue section, may delay and cause challenges in the diagnosis. And this clear cell sometimes may be so secondarily extensive that we might be biased to give a diagnosis of clear cell carcinoma. This may appear artifactually in the electron microscopy study, again blurring the diagnosis. Also, they may limit the application of immunohistochemistry. So clear cell change may collectively make the diagnosis of clear cell tumors challenging and difficult. Now, this is my last case, the pathologist dilemma. This I encountered towards the end of my preparation. A 75-year-old male, profession is doctor by profession, underwent laparoscopic cholecystectomy. Now, grossly it was around 5 × 3 × 1 cm. The wall was thickened with a small growth of around 0.5 cm in one area. Now, histopathology revealed presence of the mucosal epithelium in papillary pattern and also in tubular pattern. Now, because of the small growth in grossly in the gallbladder, he was given a diagnosis of tubulopapillary adenoma of gallbladder. But unfortunately, he developed ascites after 4 months, and the fluid was slightly mucoid and yellowish in color, and it was repeatedly, frequently, and rapidly filling up the peritoneal cavity, and he was undergoing repeated aspiration for that. Now, the smear showed presence of, you can see lot of cells over a mucoid background. These cells you can see vacuolated to clear cytoplasm. You can also see presence of some inflammatory cells. Now, what do you think this is? Now, this was differently diagnosed by the by different pathologists. Like some thought it as a metastatic adenocarcinoma of gallbladder metastasized into the peritoneum, and some thought it as a reactive mesothelial cells. And before, because of this dilemma, the clinicians hesitated to give any aggressive treatment. And while waiting for the treatment, the patient expired in the meanwhile. So what I have to tell here is that distinguishing metastatic cancers with clear cell features as essential therapeutic and prognostic considers, which we always must keep in mind. Now, my carry home message will be only this: beware of the clear cells, because they can really, really be deceptive. These are my acknowledgements. And this was my review article, which was which came out in the IJPM in the previous issue. And thank you all for the patient hearing.
Take out the slides. Thank you, Dr. Asaranti. You have in time shown some interesting cases. Now, as we have got 10 minutes with us, so I request my young friends, those are attending, can ask and clarify their doubts from Dr. Asaranti. She is ready to answer your question, because this is a very interesting and extensive area of pathology, and you must ask or clarify your doubts. Any question?
We had now, some charts, sir. We had some charts. Let me see what were there. Some
what,
charts.
What you want?
The charts were there. Some charts. Dekhla.
Chart.
Yes. Some which questions. Yes, Swanti. Dr. Gauri Shankar is raising his hand.
Yeah.
And ask him to go ahead with his question.
See, Professor Acharya is my teacher.
Yes,
he is my teacher.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Namaste. Oh, yes, yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Your talk is excellent.
Please on your video, sir. Video.
Okay. Mute, sir.
Sir, video on.
It is the video kitchen, right?
No. Okay, sir. Tell, sir.
Sorry, one last. You tell like that.
Your talk is excellent. Yeah. I learned a lot.
Thank you.
For that reason, I used to call you as a madam of mine, even if I taught you. Thank you very much. Many thanks.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Any other questions to Dr. Asaranti? She is ready to answer your question. This is a very extensive and interesting topic. I now we have got with the panelists.
Gauri Shankar.
Oh, madam.
Dr. Gauri Shankar, he is raising his hand.
Dr. Acharya is told. Gauri Shankar Acharya has told.
Hey, madam, he told.
He has already over.
Yes.
Any other postgraduates, young pathologists, this is an extensive area of pathology which interests everybody. Please ask. Dr. Asaranti is there to answer your queries. Anything? Because we have got quite good time, 10 minutes are left. If not, then I can ask our panelists, very important panelists are there. They can comment on this and add to the topic and with their experience. Dr. Dattagupta is there, Dr. Pradeep is there, Madheshwar is there. I don't know, Dr. Vassalath, also president, also there. So you can add your comment in this.
No, nothing, sir. First of all, I would like to congratulate Dr. Asaranti
for this
wonderful talk. It is much needed, and she had written a very good article in IJPM, which she showed. I think everybody can read.
Yes, I have gone through that.
It was very nice.
Very extensive article and very well informed.
The thing is that this entity was not that well recognized earlier.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And yeah. They go by many names. Clear cell sarcoma of tendency, this and that, all lot of different names are there. And so now we understand that many of them are almost similar. And that is why there are so many mimics.
Yes, sir.
Miss. And the other point is, this kind of morphology can be seen anywhere in the body.
Yes, sir.
So it is not localized to one or other organ. Yes. And therefore, whenever she has highlighted this on right from beginning till the end, that always keep it in differential diagnosis.
Yes, sir.
When
yes,
you're
sir.
Thinking of some other.
Difficult also.
When you're seeing clear cells, basically. And so this musicarnia stain is sometimes a little difficult.
Yes,
but
sir.
Anyway, if you have got the facilities to do stains for mucin, which is, that is a common thing that has to be excluded
sir.
In most areas. And immunohistochemistry, if it is there.
Sir,
so you have got an extensive collection. I must congratulate
you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
So
thank
many,
you.
All the organs and
yes, sir.
Cells. Very good,
thank Dr. You, sir. No, sir, these mucous cells can be confused with clear cells.
Yes.
But
yes.
If we can do a proper musicarnia stain, it is easy
yes,
to.
That has to be done sir. Properly. That yes, is the only sir. Thing.
That has to be done properly. Any, thank you, Dr.
Sir, one question I have got, sir. I don't
which,
know. Who.
Which question?
What who? Was the final diagnosis of the ascitic fluid cytology? So, actually, we didn't do because the patient expired. He's a doctor by profession, but 75 years old. He passed away, but he thought it was a metastatic carcinoma from the gallbladder. Because of the absence of the invasion into the muscle coat, we did not think it as a, it was not thought as a, I haven't got that case, it was some other's case. So they didn't think it as a carcinoma. But the metastasis to ascitic fluid and the followed by the demise of the patient. So that would be metastatic cells, not the mesothelial cells, with a lot of clear cytoplasm and maculatin. Madam, another chart has come recently in bladder clear cell variant.
Oh, of
Madam, another chart. Yes, sir.
You just completed.
Sir, one another? More chart has come recently in bladder clear cell variant of urothelial carcinoma was incorporated in WHO classification. Someone, Sima Kosal has written. Sir, in the bladder, we have got the clear cell carcinoma. This has been incorporated in the WHO classification recently.
Dr. Seema is one of our colleagues. She looks after the uropathology.
Yeah, she has.
That's what is present in all organs, you know. Gradually, I think whatever is left.
yes. Whatever.
I think clear cell has been separated in almost all the organs. Now they are taken separately, even in the cervix, HP positive, then clear cell tumors. And really, sometimes they are very deceptive. But some simple depending upon the site and all, especially in the GIT and the site, simple stain like, as said, musicarmine or pass with AB, they at least help us in identifying and differentiating whether there is mucin, whether there is glycogen, mucopolysaccharides. Sometimes these mesothelial cells may also appear with a lot of clear cytoplasm. So they are very deceptive, as Asranti has covered. They can be physiological clearing, they can be pathological, and we have to differentiate. It becomes very important.
Yes.
So very nice lecture, Asranti, and very
thank
nice.
Thank you, madam. This lipid also.
Dr. Asranti.
Sir.
Dr. Asranti, I have got a question for you.
Sir.
So, there is a problem with a small biopsy. What you have shown, all these surgical resected specimens.
Yes, sir.
When you get nowadays, the biopsy is getting smaller and smaller.
Yes, sir.
It has gone from scalpel edge to the needle point.
Yes,
And it becomes real difficult to just whether clear cells or appreciate the cellular morphology, etc. One should be very careful in diagnosing the small biopsy, clear cell, any pathology associated with clear cells, it becomes difficult.
So the final diagnosis of clear cell tumors or carcinoma can only be given in a big biopsy. Small biopsy, yeah. We should not venture to give a...
Yes. Like no, recent, what I am telling, because my own niece had a problem. She's 31 years, had a pelvic mass. Once she was diagnosed as renal cell osteosarcoma, a small biopsy, and subsequently it's referred to the very important surgical pathologist, and she gave the diagnosis as chondroid chondrosarcoma. So the things what she described as a clear cells, clinal cells, other things, and she gave the diagnosis other man without osteoid, without round cells. So there is a diversion. Took one chemotherapy course and subsequently changed to another type. So one should be very, very, very careful for giving a diagnosis of clear cell lesion from small biopsy. That is, other things may come up. Any other comment from...
Dr. Pradeep is there, you can ask him. He has muted himself.
Yeah, Dr. Pradeep, welcome. Just ask, Asrati is prepared to answer everybody's question.
I think the clear cell lesions have been made very clear.
Very clear.
Yes. I think it has become more confusing for the postgraduates, I think.
Basically they require an algorithm. It's better to read from everything from algorithmic point of view.
Yes.
Maybe the clear cells can be classified as the tumors which are intrinsically clear. And the tumors which can show clear cell cytoplasm. If they prepare that sort of classification, and as sir said, that every organ is going to show clear cells, so I think it is better to divide the tumors as such, and both benign as well as malignant.
So one question we have, thank you Pradeep, one question we have: what is the common cause of clear cell change? Common cause of clear cell change, I think always we tell it's a deposition of glycogen. But besides, as I have showed, so many things like lipid, mucus, and even some phagocytose material also can cause clearing. But usually this is glycogen. So if we subject it to pH 10, then we can know that this is a clear cell containing lesion. Then we have to differentiate whether it is true clear cell tumor or a variant like Dr. Pradeep has told.
Can you get more time?
Yes, sir. Some questions have come in YouTube.
No. Can you get more time for this? Can you extend it for 5
yes,
to
sir,
6
yes,
minutes?
Sir, yes, sir.
Oh, then it's okay. You answer all the questions briefly.
Pranab Barma has told, is the cause of clearing is same in all types of clear cell lesions? No, it's not same. No, of course, it's not same. It can be like artifactual also, degenerative change also. Like I showed in prostatic clear cell could be from metaplasia or degenerative changes. Even in ovary also, I didn't show that, but even in ovary also, you can get degenerative clear cell change. So the cause of clearing is not same. Of course,
not. This is so. Any other question?
No, sir. I think over. Yes, sir.
Over.
Yes,
so then I'll just give a remark. Actually, we belong to the age of histomorphology. We don't have, when I left, there was in Odisha Lestat, there is no immunohistochemistry, nothing. So we have to just become the, just see the morphology and give a diagnosis. So now I think how many mistakes we have committed. Anything, any metastatic sites, if we find clear cells, we jump immediately to the kidney. And also you find nowadays, you find the prostate. that clear cell infiltration, that is a prostatitis cases, also we commit mistake in the diagnosis. And also we find some, there to be some prognostic significance associated with the clear cells. Prognostics, some classes it becomes more aggressive and some places more metastatic or locally aggressive like that. But anyway, I have gone through your paper before just coming, and I find you have collected good material and you have presented very nicely, and it will be helpful because everything is not looking at the thing. Just seeing a slide and looking at the slide is different. Looking means just going, passing on the way, see a poster. We do not know, we just drive and go. Seeing the slide, you see the poster and go into deep into the thing. You have gone deep into the thing before coming here. Thank you. Thank you all. And that panelists who have taken, discussed very enthusiastically, and the participant also discussed very here. I'm very much happy to see all the response. And I thank you. Thank you, everybody. And my Dr. Acharya is also there, my sir, my teacher. I have taught by him in third year. So he's there. Thank you very much, Dr. Bhaschala, too.
Yes, thank you all. I think the next session will be on inflammation. All the mediators and resolution of inflammation with some interesting case discussion, like inflammatory lesions masquerading as tumorous condition. Dr. Harendra is going to present that.
Wash. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now we end this.
Madam, thank you so much.
Madam, madam should say, speak something.
I've already spoken. Thank you, everyone. I said this was a very nice lecture, and the main thing of this webinar is that we are taking the basic topics.
Yes, sir. Yes,
madam. There are so many webinars on slide seminars and current topics, etc. But we are basically taking the basic topics like granulomas, inflammation, basic clear cells as we have today taken. So these are some common topics which may be of interest and which are very important even for
alphabets.
For seniors in day-to-day, their diagnosis and reporting. So these are the basic topics which we are taking in this IAPM webinar, and I hope we get a good response. I think next will be last one, or I think we may have two more, Asranti.
We have many more, madam. I'll tell you. I'll put in the academic committee.
Okay, okay.
Yes.
Okay, so thank you, everyone.
Yes, thank you.
We hope to continue with the teaching process. And this year, we hope we will discuss something. We will have EC meeting soon, and then we will discuss. We hope we can have our meeting and all the regular processes, the regular course of the association this year.
Thank you, madam. Thank you all. Good night.
Thank you all.
Meeting ends.
Good night.
Good night. Good night, everyone.
Good night. Good night. Started with good evening, now good night.